Okay, let me begin by listing my collaborators. I'm going to sort of put together a series of papers, and they include Temple He, Dan Kapak, Slava Lysov, who's here actually, Prahar Mitra, Sabrina Pisterski, Achilles Porphyriades, and Sasha Jaboyadol. So I'm going to talk about a three-way equivalence between three things that have been discussed over the last 50 or more years. And there's a lot of literature on all three subjects, but there turns out to be rather simple transformations between them. And the three subjects are soft theorems, which go back to, in fact, I think I'm going to draw this over here so I don't have to erase it. Soft theorems, which go back to Francis Lowe in 1958, though our modern view on it is shaped by Weinberg's mid-60s paper. And then memory, which in the context of gravity goes back to 1974, Zeldovich and Polnarev. And then asymptotic symmetries, which goes back to ADM, or maybe in our more modern form, Bondi, Vandenberg, Messner, and Sachs in 62. And there are hundreds or thousands of papers on each of these subjects. And what we've understood in the last couple of years is that these subjects are very simply related. And I want to talk about this triangle. And basically, this line is simply a Fourier transform. This line is a Ward identity. And this line is a vacuum transition. And this triangle echoes throughout much of modern physics. Today, I'm just going to discuss one example of it. But the triangle occurs in QED. It occurs in non-abelian gauge theories. It occurs in gravity and many more. There are triangles related to leading soft theorems. And then these, again, have echoes, subleading, sub-subleading, so on. We can talk about the triangle already exists at the classical level. So there's a classical story. And then there's a quantum story, which involves interesting anomalies. And also we can talk about, we can talk about four-dimensional Minkowski space. We can talk about higher dimensions. We can talk about cosmology. And this is perhaps not unrelated to what Juan was talking about last week. Anti-de Sitter seems not to have a version of this because it's gapped. So every combination of all these things is a different. Some combinations have already been covered in the last few years, but every combination has its own peculiar and interesting characteristics and applications, but I'm just going to go through one example today. And it's oddly the best understood example, and it's the one that involves gravity. Gravity is usually the thing that we understand the least, but in this case, for really peculiar, not for technical reasons, but really for peculiar historical reasons. I guess it's just the relativists are smarter than the field theorists or something. The gravity case was understood better than the, and I'm going to talk about a leading soft theorem, and it turns out that the leading one has no quantum corrections, and therefore my discussion will be both classical and quantum, and I'm going to talk about four-dimensional Minkowski space. And in this case, I can put a little more detail on the triangle. It would be gravitational memory. There's also electromagnetic and non-abelian gauge memory, but today I'll be talking about gravitational memory, which was discussed in 74. And it would be the soft graviton theorem, which was found in 60. And it will be the BMS symmetry, which was discovered in 62. So I'm going to relate three things that were discovered between 62 and 74. Now, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to describe each of these things, each of the corner of the triangle, and then I'm going to describe how they're connected. Oh, and then at the end, I believe that this triangle has very important implications for black hole information, in that it implies that black hole carry infinite amount of hair, and so I'll talk a little bit at the end about implications for black hole information. Everything I do has to turn into a black hole at some point or another. All right. So let me just remind those who don't know what the soft graviton theorem is. So the soft graviton theorem says that if we take any scattering amplitude with any set of external particles, and then one of which is a graviton, whose momenta characterized by some polarization epsilon and momentum q, and we take that momentum to zero, which is the soft means small momentum, that's equal to, and I'm suppressed factors of G Newton and 2 pi and so on in this talk, that's equal to the sum, so these have momenta p1, p2, to Pn, if we have n plus 1 external particles, including the graviton, that's equal to the sum of the graviton polarization, epsilon mu nu, P mu k, P nu k, divided by q dot pk, sum over k, equals 1 to n. And here I'm adopting the convention that ingoing and outgoing particles have opposite sign of the energy. So I just have one term instead of two terms. Times the same amplitude, but without the graviton. Okay, let me call this An plus 1. And let me call this An. All right. So,
This is, I think, for non-exceptional external momenta, right? Namely, you cannot, if one of the channels has zero momentum, you also need to sum over.
You mean all these p's have to be non-zero?
Also the sums of these p's. For instance, if you have forward scattering and you are on top of the Coulomb pole, then you have to add some other. contribution.
And it's infinity equals infinity.
What do you mean?
Well, if you have p.
Yeah, it's infinity, but what multiplies that scattering? I mean, in other words, that q has to be smaller than any other internal momentum.
Any other, not just smaller than all the p's, smaller than all the sums of the p's?
I'm working on something similar, and I know that in some cases you need to add emission of the graviton from some internal momentum if that internal momentum is very soft.
Okay. I didn't know about this. I hope it doesn't affect what I'm going to say. It sounds interesting, though. I'm sure it just makes the story prettier when you take it. All right. So, but I'll be interested to understand it. And just for those of you, what the way this happens, just to sketch it for those who, it's a very simple thing. Weinberg's paper is really very simple. If you want to go from this diagram to this diagram, the first thing you have to do is you have to take a graviton and attach it in all possible ways. And according to LSC reduction, the external legs are truncated, but since now this line is no longer external, and it's almost on shell, momentum is small, and this little factor here is q dot p, and the factor on the top is essentially the vertex here. And then you might ask, well, what if I attach to external lines? Oh, my gosh, plus order q to the zero. This has correction, right? This is just the leading pole. And then you can't get these single, you can Weinberg showed that you can't get the singularities attaching to an internal line, so that's all that you get. Okay, so it's a very simple formula. Okay, that's the soft theorem. Now let's talk about something less familiar, gravitational memory. And so gravitational memory says, let's imagine we have a gravitational detector consisting of just two inertial masses. And then we send some gravity waves, or in fact it can be any kind of waves, past it. Like at LIGO, for example, that'll cause these things to oscillate. But along with the oscillation is a DC drift. So that at the end of the day, after the gravity wave passes, you can show that there's no net velocity of the two. If they start out with no net velocity, the inertial detectors, they end up with no net velocity, but there's a change in their separation, delta S. So they don't come back quite to where they started from. It's sort of reminiscent of a Berry phase type thing. And this was discovered by Zeldovich and Polnarev. This was Weinberg 62. This was Weinberg 65, I guess. This was Zeldovich and Polnarev in 74. And then there's what I consider an important paper on the subject by Berginsky and Thorne in 87, and then there was Christodoulou in 91, who, as the last person to write an important paper on the subject, got his name attached to it, and it's sometimes called Christodoulou memory. Now,
Andy, do you need three test masses to be able to compare the distances, or is
three?
Yes, so you can compare two distances, but you just need...
No, you just, you know, you send a light ray over there and you see how long it takes for it. You hold up a mirror, see how long it takes to come back. You do it later on and it's different. And it's not just, I'm going to write down the formula in a second. It's not just a change in the distance, it's, there's also a rotation involved. So how do you compute this? Well, now I have to write down a metric. So let me write down the flat Minkowski metric in, let me, maybe I won't want to erase this either, I'll write it over here. Here I have, I want to introduce a retarded coordinate u, and lines of fixed u and varying r are null. And then I have a sphere at null infinity, which is parameterized by z and z bar. And the flat Minkowski metric is ds squared is equal to minus du squared minus 2 du dr plus r squared gamma z z bar z z bar. That's the flat Minkowski metric. If in an asymptotically flat setting, there'll be corrections to this. There are a bunch of corrections. But the one that I'm interested in now is plus r czz dz squared plus complex conjugate. So here, gamma zz bar is just the unit metric on the round sphere. So up to here is just Minkowski space. This represents, if we look out near infinity, z and z bar are the transverse directions. So this represents a gravitational wave. If CZZ is non-zero, there may be a gravitational wave. Actually, there's an important subtlety there. It can be non-zero without a gravitational wave. So it basically represents gravitational wave. Okay. Now, if we want to compute this effect, all we do is we write down the equation for geodesic deviation. So let's call this the separation between these geodesics, S mu, and the equation is that d squared, which is in every GR textbook, d squared S mu d tau squared is equal to r mu nu lambda rho up to a sine t nu S lambda t rho, where t is just the tangent vector to either one of these guys. They equal to the order in which we're working. Now you can just plug this in to here, this kind of metric, and ask what happens. And you find that it becomes du squared sz, the interesting component, is equal to gamma zz bar over 2r, du squared czz. This is small. It's falling off like 1 over r. So it's a small effect. Czz sz. And we can solve that to see that delta s, this would be, have to have a bar on it, delta sz bar is equal to, if we integrate twice over with respect to u, 1 over 2r gamma z bar z czz delta czz sc, where delta czz, so let's now imagine we have some gravity waves coming out here. And here we have some CZZ initial. And here we have some CZZ final. And delta CZZ is just equal to CZZ final minus CZZ initial.
And I thought C was zero for the background without the gravitational.
Yes. Why not? I said almost. Almost. Now, so that is the key point, all right? So if you compute, for example, the, right, so I was about to ask, but Gary asked it for me, why isn't this zero? This, by the way, okay, before I do it, this is the formula. It's written in 1,000 different forms, but this is the classic formula for gravitational memory, which appears in Zeldovich and Polnarov and every. And this form of it, I think, was in a paper by, what's his name, Ludvigsen or something, 30 years ago. Okay, so now, if we look, for example, and this is a really important point, if we look, for example, at this component of the Riemann tensor, or the Weyl tensor, it's equal to R times dz squared cz bar z bar minus dz squared dz bar squared czz. And this thing has a kernel. And so C can be non-zero without resulting in any curvature. And indeed, the solution to this, now you have to check all the other curvature components, but the solution to this is CZZ is equal to, the 2 is for later convenience, or do I put a minus 2, dz squared times any function of z and z bar.
So you're saying it doesn't affect the curvature, but it's also not pure gauge?
Aha! I'm going to make you wait to answer that question. It doesn't? Okay. All right. Maybe you've guessed it by now. It is pure gauge. And the gauge transformation that produces it is a BMS transformation. And it's a gauge transformation which acts non-trivially on physical states. So, but that'll be coming in a minute.
You're missing factor of I. That looks imaginary.
Yeah, I must have missed a factor of I here. Yeah, there must be an I here. And in fact, it's a tilde. There's also twos and stuff. Okay? All right. So now, let's now get to, so this is all review. Let's now get to Burginsky and Thorne. Paper. So Burginsky and Thorne, but now you need to compute this, what this delta CZZ is. And Burginsky and Thorne computed it, and I'm just going to copy an equation out of their 87 paper. And their 87 paper doesn't use this coordinate system, it just uses eta mu nu plus h mu nu, the standard flat Minkowski metric plus mu nu. And they write the following thing. The change in what we're calling C, they call H, the transverse traceless part, is equal to, they considered, what was the setup they were considering? They considered processes of collision and scattering of black holes or massive stars, which were labeled, and they use weak field approximation. They could consider a bunch of massive stars or black holes that come in and scatter and go back out, and are characterized by initial and final four momenta, p mu k. They have n of them. They write the formula for n of them, and they just solve for the retarded propagator. And they introduce a vector q hat, where q hat squared is equal to 1, as a coordinate for on the S2 at null infinity. And so they're computing the change in h mu nu from here to here. And their formula is 1 over r times the sum over k, pk mu p k nu over, then they introduce something else, a null vector q, whose components are 1 q hat, so it squares to zero, over pk dot q. Okay, now it's hard to miss the similarity between this formula here and this formula here, even though it actually was missed for the last 40 years. 30 years. If we contract, we could, of course, contract both sides with epsilon mu nu, and it will look more similar. Now, it seems to not be exactly the same, but it is exactly the same. There are a couple things you have to do to make it, to see that it's exactly the same. The first thing is that this is a formula in momentum space. It's a pole in momentum space. These q's are not exactly the same. This q is going to zero. Their q is always fixed to one. But this is a delta h. So it's a step function. You know, it's the change in h from the initial to the final. So to show that these formulas are exactly the same, which Jaboda and I do in our paper, you have to really use two things. One is simply that a step function of retarded time u can be written as the Fourier transform of a pole. Okay? So that thing has that q is omega times this q. They're getting a pole. They're calculating a step function. The other thing is that here we've got the amplitudes on the two sides of the equation. But to see that, you know, there's a formula, a semi-classical formula of the form epsilon mu nu h mu nu. If you want to ask what is the gravitational field produced in this n-particle scattering process, if you work that out carefully, it's basically, as a function of q, it's again with the tilde, a n plus 1 of p1 pk q epsilon over a n of p1 pn. Okay, so, you know, getting all the factors and the 1 over r is a little point, but, you know, getting it all to work out is just completely straightforward algebra. So these are the same formulas. Weinberg was scattering particles. Brzezinski and Thorne were scattering stars. Yes?
Are both of them true for any theory of gravity, metric theory of gravity that reduces to the standard linear result?
Yeah, they're both true for any theory of gravity because they're deep infrared formulas. And we'll see in a moment that they're connected to symmetries. Now,
so you're saying the restriction on infrared in the low energy theorem translates into something like you look at t equals minus infinity, t equals plus infinity, you look at what happened.
I mean, a step function is a Fourier transform of a pole. And so this answered a question that now we've explained this and this and the connection between them.
But this side, that formula on this side has corrections of order 0, q,
Yeah.
Which don't produce a step function, but they produce something. So what is the limit on the other side? Long time?
Oh, okay. So that is, you're asking me about this.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we wrote a paper on that. So one of the nice things about this is the unique example where all three corners of the triangle were known before. In basically all the other examples, one or two corners were known. Okay? So for that one, for the subleading term, we looked at that and we said there must be a new kind of gravitational memory that people haven't discussed. So there is. We wrote a paper on a new kind of gravitational memory, and it's has a chirality to it, and it has to do with time delays of counter-rotating objects. So,
okay. But when does it become negligible?
With Sasha, I wrote that. What?
So when does it become negligible?
Well, the fact that if you look at the memory formula, you see this, by the way, I should stress that it's that gravitational memory is probably going to be measured in the coming decades, if not sooner. I mean, the people have been, the Braginsky and Thorne were doing a survey of how you might measure this effect. It's probably going to be, you know, the pulsar timing array, the proposal there now for me. So it's probably going to be measured despite the 1 over R. Mm-hmm. This 1 over R is big because they're looking at, you know, things in the other side of the galaxy. You know, there are also fantastic amounts of energy involved when you merge two black holes, and somehow that comes out, and it seems to be a little bit harder to measure than the ordinary gravitational waves. It's also, unlike the ordinary effect, it's cumulative. So like with a pulsar timing array, where they look at it every few weeks, they're never going to see something like this. It's a very different problem trying to measure the memory. You know, if you're coming back and looking at something every 3 weeks and you want to know how it changes, you have a better chance of seeing
the gravity. It's always the same sign. It's always separating.
You know, I got a little confused about that. No, I don't think it's always separating.
So what do you mean by cumulative? It could oscillate.
If you have an oscillating wave going through, if you have a gravity wave, if we look at how big this effect is for, say, a gravity wave going through scry, you know, the usual LIGO effect, the things will move back and forth, and then it will stop. But, you know, it will build up over each cycle the longer the wave is on. It's proportional to the total energy flux. That's what I want to say. If you scale up the total energy flux, it scales up proportionally.
The corrections to this are 1 over R squared?
To this formula? Right. So the subleading memory effect, the fact that it's subleading, that means it's less infrared divergent. So you get another factor of 1 over R. And so any kind of, you're not going to measure this, what we call the spin memory effect from things in distant galaxy, but it's possible that something like Elie's comet going through ELISA or something would make a big enough effect. I don't know. You know, you have to look at completely different things.
So are there in principle an infinite number of subleading triangles of this kind, or are they really only things that are infrared divergent and they stop at some finite place for a given problem?
Well, David wrote the seminal paper on this in the 60s and said that it stops here. We don't, as they go further down, we understand them less and less. I don't know what the sub-subleading guy is. It's confusing. It has to do with, well, there are different ways of understanding why it stops, but okay, yeah.
Andy, I have a very naive question. This kind of thing, does it show up in hydrodynamics as well?
Well, they use the word memory. I don't know. Okay. But the thing I wanted to say is, you know, I've been working on this soft stuff, and it always bothered me to have all this. I've always wanted to make the argument that, you know, I'm going to be talking about symmetries in a minute, and I like to make the argument, or I did make the argument, that these symmetries are real and non-trivial because they relate matrix elements involving soft gravitons. But it sort of bothered me. You know, you can't really, how do you measure a soft graviton? And
well, this is how you measure a soft graviton. People are building detectors. You know, you take two things like this and you. So it makes, in my mind, it makes soft particles more physical to look at them in this way, even if it is just a Fourier transform. Okay, so far I haven't said anything about asymptotic symmetries. That's the right-hand corner of the lower right-hand corner of the triangle. And so let me now, in this context, the relevant asymptotic symmetries are the BMS symmetries, which were discovered in 1962. And they found that there are many ways of describing how you get to this result, but basically they found that if you go into these coordinates that I've written over there, which are sort of like Pfefferman-Graham coordinates for Minkowski space, then the following vector fields, zeta is equal to, depends on a function f of z, z bar, du, plus gamma z, z bar over r, dzf, dz bar, plus dzf, dz bar, f, dz, and then plus more terms, preserve that these are not all the BMS transformations. These are the so-called super translations. There are also Lorentz transformations mixed in here. They certainly preserve this form of the metric, and they argued, and it's been argued in many different ways, that that these act non-trivially, that they change the physical scattering data at null infinity. So we should not think of these, we do not want to quotient out by these things. They're non-trivial diffeomorphisms, and there are infinitely many of them. They're parametrized by a function. Now, of course, if f is equal to a constant, then zeta f is just equal to du, so that is just the Hamiltonian. And on the other hand, if f is an L equals 1 spherical harmonic, you can see that, after it's not completely obvious in these coordinates, but you can see that this corresponds to a spatial translation. But more generally, we have, let me draw this sphere out here. We have, for general f, what we're doing is we're moving the sphere at different points on the sphere, moving it along null infinity by different amounts. So kind of what happens, the way I think about this, is that all the points at null infinity are out of causal contact. So it's an ultra-local theory. There's nothing tying together these points on the sphere. And so you can move them up and down independently. It would sort of violate causality to have some principle that forced you to move them all together. All right.
Should I think of this as something like the, for asymptotic ADS, the formal symmetries, or is this more? I mean, it's bigger, but.
Well, are they? I mean, it's a lot like the Virasoro symmetry that happens in ADS 3, and indeed. Yeah. Brown and Hanau modeled their analysis.
So morally, they're the same.
Well, they're different groups, and so the consequences are going to be going to be different. But it's that kind of thing.
Can I think of this as the fact that the energy is conserved at each angle? So once things get far away and have energy going in some angle, it will be conserved at that angle and not go to some other neighboring angle.
Yes. Yeah. I'll. That's the soft graviton theorem is the matrix element of that conservation law.
You know,
horizons have the same property, right? That every point is out of causal contact.
Yeah.
So do you think that there's, you know, some aspect of this could be carried over to black hole horizons?
I'm actually working on a project in that with, maybe. Be happy to talk to you about it.
Do you have any intuition about the second term in Zeta there, like why you have to adjust transversely?
Why you have to do a diffeomorphism on the sphere?
Yeah, there's, in a specific correlated way.
I wish I had a good answer to that, but this term is crucial in everything. You can't just drop this term. In fact, at the end of the day, that's the one that, yeah, I don't have a good answer.
Is there plus dot dot?
Well, there's some more terms. There's a d by dr term and so on. And then it starts to get into the details of exactly how we're doing our gauge fixing. I mean, just like with the Virasoro transformations in ADS3, it's only the first couple terms that are formalism independent.
Are all the other terms suppressed by another power 1 over r?
Well, there's a term that's dz, gamma z, z bar, dz, dz bar, f, dr, without even a 1 over r in it. And then the rest are. That one is a little bit non-universal, though. I haven't told you enough about that would be there with the standard coordinates, but I haven't told you enough here about what coordinates I'm working in to necessarily have that term, but you often see that one. Yeah.
I'm a little confused by Gary's question, because I was thinking of this, as you said, as an analogy with the ADS3 situation where it doesn't count as a redundant gauge transformation, I thought, because it's happening out at the boundary and it's kind of frozen. Whereas a black hole horizon is, you know. Do you really know?
What was Juan's dictum during Ted's seminar? Don't ask questions about things which have not yet. I don't know the.
Don't ask questions about other people's questions.
No, it's a very, very interesting, which I'd be happy to discuss about how you think about it on a black hole horizon. But there's all kinds of other stuff which comes.
I mean, why would it be frozen out in that case? I'm confused.
Maybe it isn't. I'm just not making a statement about it. I'm hoping it isn't, but I'm not making a statement about it.
And the metric is asymptotically Minkowski, right?
Right.
I thought the du square is just like that. I thought there was a correction.
Oh, yeah, yeah. No, there's in fact an important correction, which is the body mass aspect.
The Bondi mass.
Times du squared. Yeah. I'm not. There's lots of sub. These are the flat terms. I wrote this one just because I needed it in my formulas. Okay, but there are more terms there.
So isn't it the next question that the first term there would take the sphere at u equals constant and turn it into something which is not metric sphere? You're just trying to undo that.
Right.
You're trying to preserve the geometry.
That's what this term does.
Oh, it's not the second term. It's the third term usually that does that. Is that the conformal transformation on this sphere?
You need this term. All right. Let me. I don't think I'm going to have too much useful to say about that. All right. But there are some very simple things to say, which is that now we can ask, getting back to somebody's question, maybe Mark or Eva, what happens to CZZ under a supertranslation? And delta CZZ is equal to, it turns out, minus 2 dz squared. And delta, that's why I put that minus 2 in there. This delta C is just equal to F. So this equation tells us that the C is the gold, this symmetry is spontaneously broken, and C is the Goldstone boson of the spontaneously broken supertranslation invariance. And this equation has four zero modes, which are just the four time and space translations. All right, now at Joe's birthday last year, I defined a subgroup of BMS, which was sort of of the BMS acting up here and the analogous BMS acting down here. I put some boundary conditions here. I found a subgroup that preserved those boundary conditions and argued that that gives us a symmetry of the S matrix that we could write. If B is the generator of BMS transformations, we have BS minus SB is equal to 0, commutes with the S matrix. And this is an operator statement. So we can take any out state and any in state, and that will be equal to 0. This is infinitely many symmetries of the S matrix. And after a lot of algebra, this turns out to be just Weinberg's soft graviton theorem in disguise. So Weinberg's soft graviton theorem is the Ward identity of BMS symmetry, and that's equivalent. One can also show that this, as Juan was suggesting, this is the same thing as it's equivalent to the statement that energy is conserved at every angle, that the energy incoming from here is always, when you're careful about the precise coordinate variant definition of it, local energy in general relativity, that the incoming energy from square minus, total incoming is equal to the total outgoing at the opposing angle on scribe plus. And those are the infinite number of conservation laws. Okay.
To lead in order, this doesn't, so if you have to lead in order the scattering of two particles going into two other angles,
yeah,
it doesn't seem to be the case, right?
It doesn't seem to, but it is when you go through it carefully.
To lead in order, in G Newton, the energy is not conserved at each angle. And then this soft stuff is for order G Newton.
No. It's conserved order by order. Because that process will always create a soft graviton, which will redistribute energy around the sphere.
Wouldn't it be the amplitude to create another soft particle? Isn't it proportional to the square root of G Newton?
Depends on your conventions and how many powers of G Newton okay.
So how do you see that energy at every angle is conserved?
Yeah, this drives people crazy. It's totally true.
Well,
so
it's not really true for other what?
Other fields. You know,
also true in electromagnetism, the charge is conserved at every angle. We were talking about experiments to verify this, but Okay, to answer the question in the kind of detail, and I think I did this a year ago because it also upset people a year ago, it seems. I don't want to write down all those equations. I mean, I have just some other points to make now. I'm happy to discuss it later. But let me just make it plausible. You see, here we've got if F is a constant, we know that the symmetry associated with this is global energy conservation. Now we have infinitely more symmetries, and we know that symmetries always imply conservation laws in a unitary theory. And it's not too hard to guess, though, if we're now allowed to translate individual points, that the associated conservation law should be energy into each angle.
Yeah, that makes sense asymptotically. I mean, when you are in one region, one asymptotic region makes sense for the distributed in the energy as you go further and further in R. But that it holds when you go from the past to the future, it seems.
Yeah, I mean, think of Baba scattering two electrons in, out, different angles.
Well, they create a soft graviton. It will create a soft graviton that will redistribute energy around the sphere.
What about the charge example?
Yeah, I was referring to charge.
The photon carries zero charge.
Right. Yeah.
But it has a non-zero radial component of the electric field at infinity, and the charge at every angle I will define is the only gauge invariant way of defining it is the electric field at that energy. So soft photons definitely redistribute the charge flux through any angle, though of course they don't affect the total charge at all. And this Baba scattering process will create a soft photon, which will conspire, as it must.
So you're defining the charge current.
I'm defining the charge at a given angle as the radial component of the electric field. I don't think there's another reasonable definition of it.
Okay, so then that conquers intuition. Changes intuition. The soft gravitons or soft photons don't carry charge or energy, so how can they redistribute energy? But you're defining energy in a way that makes...
I don't think there is another coordinate invariant way to define it.
So in the case of energy, again...
The body mass aspect.
Well, for charge, there is a gauge invariant way of defining things. It's what the people who build detectors measure, right? That's
radial components of electric field.
Total charge in a given,
Well, they see tracks. The electrons. Yeah, they see tracks in detectors. Exactly. Yeah, but there must be some way of carefully explaining the connection with what you're saying.
I see what you're saying. So maybe there is. Yeah, in a U1 theory, it's more... In a non-abelian theory, you wouldn't be able to do this. But in a U1 theory, there might be two gauge invariant things, right? I guess the radial component of the electric field and the charge current are both separately gauge invariant.
Okay.
But Andy, you're saying you just checked this. You did the calculation.
Yeah. And it's when you set it up in the right way, it's...
I think maybe an analogy for this is let's consider the two-dimensional conformal field theory case and you insert some operators, right? So then they will create the stress tensor wave that will be conserved to the future. I mean, you solve just the equations of conservation of stress tensor, and that wave of stress tensor will be conserved independent of what other operators you try to detect in the future. Is this a reasonable analogy? So if you had a four-point function, for example, you might... Well, you would want to define it so that this stress tensor annihilates after you insert the other two points. But you are somehow taking a Lorentzian point of view where even when you detect the other, you insert some other operators who have the same wave of stress tensor that continues in the future.
Yeah. I'm not sure if that's exactly the same or not.
Can I just add one more thing? Yeah. If you had a single particle just going through space, right, it would start at theta equal to zero and end up at theta equal to pi. But you're identifying the generators at scribe plus and scribe minus that those are the same angle. Is that right? Because they meet at I minus at a point.
Right. Okay, I zero.
So at I naught. Okay. So that's a key part of this idea that you actually switch it.
Right. So, I mean, one thing, I'm just going to say this, and because I want to make the other, go on to other points, but suppose we start with just a theory with electric field. Maybe this is going to upset people more, I don't know. But okay, so the charge would be constant. Here. And so the radial component electric field has to go from Q to zero everywhere along here. So that's what I mean by. But now, if we do a boost on this situation, it will boost in such a way that there will be a kind of antipodal identification. And the electric field may no longer be constant, but since you're boosting away from points on scribe plus and towards points on scribe minus, you get an antipodal identification.
Not to distract too much from the talk, but I think you can also see this: the conservation between scribe minus and scribe plus is intimately tied to what boundaries are satisfied at spatial infinity.
Yeah.
And so if you just start in the middle and you consider some configuration where the electric field lines have some well-defined exit through spatial infinity, so they go through these directions and not those directions, then you can sort of see by causality that the same must be true on scribe plus and scribe minus. Right? There's just no way, as you say, that everything is ultra-local when you evolve along scribe plus or scribe minus or scribe plus, including starting at spatial infinity.
Yeah.
So I think that's a way to explain this conservation law.
Yeah. So maybe another way I could say, of course, my demonstration depended crucially on the boundary conditions that I imposed here. And this was oddly, I mean, in order to define gravitational scattering, you must impose boundary conditions out here that relate the data at the past of scribe plus to the future of scribe minus. As far as I know, there's only one Lorentz and CPT invariant way of specifying that boundary condition, and that's the one that I gave, and moreover, the agreement of this with the soft graviton theorem implies that boundary condition used in real space coordinates is the one that's implicitly being used when we do Feynman diagrams. Okay.
Actually, can I just ask one more question? So if you're thinking about massive sources, if you have massless sources that go out to null infinity, that?
Actually, on the contrary, and I should have said this, this work here was done only for massless stuff.
Okay.
And the generalization to massive particles we're writing a paper on it now. I mean, I think it does all trivially generalize, but massive particles somehow are more complicated. All right. So, what do I want to do now? So, I need to do this last leg here. And we've done this. How can we understand the direct relationship between gravitational memory and BMS symmetries? And after some work using the constraint equations, one can derive the following formula that in this kind of setup, that let me define TUU as the limit as r goes to infinity of r squared times t matter UU plus T gravitational UU, where T gravitational UU is just the square of, this is called the Bondinus. So this is the total radiative energy rescaled by a factor of R squared, which just cancels the fact that we're integrating over a sphere whose volume is going like R squared. So this is the appropriately rescaled radiative energy flux at scribe plus. And one finds that this C final minus C initial is equal to, which is what I call delta C ZZ bar, is equal to, let me put a squiggle here so I don't have to put in the factors, integral d squared w, g, a Green's function, gzz bar ww bar, tuu of ww bar. In other words, if you know the energy flux through null infinity, the radiative energy flux through null infinity, you can work out, and I'm considering a situation here where there's nothing coming in from past null infinity. It's a little more complicated than that. But you can work out what this delta C is. And this Green's function is just the, essentially the two-point function of a scalar on the sphere, a conformal scalar on the sphere. It's very infrared divergence. This effect really spreads out in a kind of surprising way over the sphere. It's very non-local in the transverse directions. And so we get a delta C here. So what is the picture here? And this is the formula for the delta C. So since it's flat before and flat after, the initial and final configurations differ by a BMS transformation. And the BMS transformation is just the thing that produced this delta C. So we can think of a radiation flux through null infinity as a kind of domain wall which separates two BMS inequivalent vacua. Now, then what you can show, and I won't go through the details, this is in my paper with Sasha, is what happens is very beautiful. So let's imagine that we have a bunch of, we fill the sphere at null infinity with a bunch of inertial detectors, and we send the wave through. Then all their positions are going to be moved around according to this gravitational memory formula. Those positions are just exactly the BMS transformations, which don't preserve. It's exactly this diffeomorphism of the sphere here. So you can literally see the BMS transformation acting on this array of detectors on the sphere. So that is this last line here, that when you have a vacuum transition induced by any kind of energy, anything that puts an imprint on the gravitational field, it will generally push you into another vacuum. That's characterized by a BMS transformation for which there's a very explicit formula here. And the memory effect is just that these inertial detectors get moved around according to this BMS thing, BMS transformation. Okay. Now, the last thing I want to say is, what is the consequence of all this for the information puzzle? And I'll be brief. The first thing is that it's not true that black holes have no hair. In fact, they have an infinite amount of hair. A black hole, a BMS transformation of a black hole, is both a classically and a quantum inequivalent object. In other words, if we add a soft graviton to a black hole, it is not the same object anymore. It has different angular momentum. And really, BMS already said this in 62, that BMS transformations change physical states. So the no-hair theorem is a theorem about diffeomorphism classes of solutions, but we should not regard those all as physically equivalent. So Hawking evaporation, moreover, we have infinitely many conservation laws.
Let's see, so if they describe different black holes, do they contribute to the black hole entropy?
Very good question.
Do they contribute infinitely?
Well, we're trying to compute it. It's related to Gary's question.
Well, do they contribute differently to the black hole entropy than they contribute to the entropy of the vacuum?
Yeah.
I mean, there are an infinite number of vacuum.
I can't answer. Let me just say my two more. I mean, these are all things that I believe should be part of the discussion about black hole information. Mm-hmm. So there's also, we know that energy, we've long known that energy must be conserved in black hole evaporation, and that the final state of the outgoing Hawking radiation plus the final state of the black hole, even though the Hawking calculation gives us a thermal flux which doesn't conserve energy, we know that somehow by hand we have to force energy to be conserved. But that's one conservation law, and that correlation between the energy of the black hole and the energy of the outgoing Hawking radiation can't possibly have anything to do with the information puzzle because it's only one conservation law. Now we've got infinitely many conservation laws. And not only these, but the ones coming from the subleading soft graviton theorem. And so then it becomes a real question whether, we believe that it comes from a symmetry, that these conservation laws are valid in the quantum theory, and so we should understand how that affects the Hawking radiation. And the last statement, which is related or almost equivalent to what I've been saying, is that part of the statement about energy information loss is that the black hole evaporates and the remaining vacuum is unique and can't store information. In fact, that's not true. The vacuum is infinitely degenerate and could store an arbitrary amount of information. Now, maybe there's some argument that this, but certainly I think that these points should be taken into account. And I will stop there.
Here you're talking about, I mean, it's basically very long wavelength stuff, right? So it wouldn't apply to, say, black holes in a box or an ADS or something like that, right? It's not really here that's localized near the black hole.
I think it's a little confusing where this stuff is. It certainly is long wavelength. In a sense, you could try to make that into an argument, but if you were to study quantum gravity by putting it in a box and taking that box out to infinity, you would miss all of this. Right. So I'm not sure that I myself would not dismiss the relevance of that of this on the on from that point of view.
But there's not an ADS version of this here. Is
there is not an ADS version of this, but I believe that in ADS, of course, there isn't strictly an information puzzle for large black holes. There is for small black holes in ADS, but to really understand it, we have to go to some limit, which is essentially like going to the flat space limit, and I think what we're seeing here is that this limit is very, very subtle.
Andy? It seems to me a little misleading to say that there's an infinite amount of black hole hair, because we're looking at isolated black holes, which are asymptotically flat, and what you've said is that there's an infinite number of vacua that it could be approaching. So it's basically just taking any vacua you want and putting a black hole in that one.
There is not a solutions, physically inequivalent solutions of the Einstein equation are not labeled by stationary solutions of the Einstein equation are not labeled by mass and angular momentum. That's also true when you don't have a black hole.
So there, you have an infinite number of vacua, and the graviton, in a sense, is a Goldstone boson.
The soft graviton.
The arbitrarily soft graviton.
Yeah.
Now, and the low energy and the soft energy theorems are the Ward identities.
Spontaneously broken Ward identities of that symmetry. Yeah.
Is there a nice way to write down some kind of gauge invariant thing that diagnoses which of these vacua you're
order parameter?
Well, there's charges.
I guess you gave it in terms of some.
There's charges. There's infinitely many charges.
In the gravity.
Yes. Like integrals over.
Yes, yes. The charges, and the charges, in fact, generate the symmetry.
Yeah.
Okay. And the charges are just, there's a charge for every function f, and the charge for every function f is just the integral at what we call scribe plus minus, the past of future null infinity, the two sphere. D squared z gamma z z bar, the function f of z z bar times the body mass aspect. And Slava and I and whoever was showed that these charges generate via Dirac brackets the symmetry.
That's true, but these are zero for the entire infinite class of vacua, right? The mass aspect is available identically for each member of that infinite class of vacua.
Right.
So you can't use this to distinguish two vacuum states.
Yeah.
They're all on charge because the algebra is abelian for supertranslations.
No. Wait, why is this zero?
Isn't the mass
zero?
Yeah, I don't think there's one true Minkowski space and then there's these gauge transform versions of it. I mean, so you could always set Ci to zero, right? Because you don't know what Ci is initially. It's the difference between the C's, which is...
Okay, so this thing is different. That's a good point. This thing is different for different... But still the angular momentum... right, so I have to get to look at something different to diagnose the different vacua. So the angular momenta will certainly be different.
Each vacuum has a different angular momentum subgroup of the BMS group, which vanishes. There's not a unique angular momentum subgroup of the BMS group, is there? I think you're right that if you choose given generates the BMS group, and you define, if you choose something which is algebraically an angular momentum algebra, it may pick out a unique vacuum.
No, there's a unique one, right? Well, I mean,
this is not all the BMS generators.
It's also
this is the super translations.
Yeah.
And if we write down all the BMS generators, then we will get something non-zero.
That's true.
Yeah.
Could you just define vacuum?
A state with zero energy.
A state with zero energy, okay.
Yeah.
So, and is QF BMS invariant? I think he just wrote.
Super translation invariant, but not BMS invariant.
Andy, if we take a star, we form a star and it goes supernova, we know that information is conserved.
Yeah.
And we know that that's conserved for other reasons, and it has nothing to do with soft gravitons, I think. Maybe you'll tell me. There isn't. But we think it's another story. It has to do with, you know, quantum field theory being a quantum mechanical system, unitary evolution holds, et cetera, et cetera.
Steve, that's not really true, because there are amplitudes where you emit
arbitrarily soft gravitons in the process of that star going supernova.
Okay, there are some soft gravitons.
If you don't take them all into account, you're not dealing with a unitary scattering.
So you can lose some extra information in soft gravitons if you're not careful. But, you know, the other stuff that comes out, you know, the whole thing is unitary because, you know, it's basically evolution and local quantum field theory, and that's a unitary story. Let me just finish. Now, in the black hole case, you're saying somehow that there's a completely different explanation, it looks like, for why you have unitary evolution when you form a black hole and it evaporates.
Wait, I was not suggesting a solution to... I was not suggesting a solution to the information problem. Cameras, not suggesting the problem. I'm saying that we. Okay. This seems relevant to the discussion.
Okay. Well, in the ADS3 case, we also have an infinite number of conservation laws and so on. Well, we have to take that into account. But, it's part of the story, but it's not. It's not
right.
Most of them.
And there, it's clear how it connects to the flat space limit. I think it isn't pretty well understood how the Virasoro algebra in ADS3 turns into the BMS algebra in the flat space limit.
Kind of, but that's a confusing story because there are no gravitons in three dimensions, so there's not really a soft graviton. I don't. There's only soft gravitons, no hard ones. Yeah.
In the sense you're talking about, does QED have an infinite number?
Yes, you get it by adding soft photons.
Sorry, I'm further behind. Are you saying that in the process you start in one of these vacua and you end up in a different one?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So is that different from, say, ordinary spontaneous symmetry breaking, let's say global spontaneous symmetry breaking, where let's say you have a moduli space and, you know, there are different vacua. There, if you form a black hole and evaporate, you wouldn't get shifted along that moduli space of vacua.
I think that is different because there you know, it's not a those symmetries are that are related to those Goldstone vacua are not allowed to be angle dependent. So somehow the vacuum at every angle is forced to be tied together. So it's a much more rigid structure in it. So if you have something going on at infinity, some global spontaneous symmetry breaking, and the scalar field is at some point, forming and evaporating a black hole can't change that VEV. Here, they're liberated from one another by the locality, the ultra-locality at infinity. And so you can make a black hole and move around in the moduli space of this vacua at a finite energy.
So in cost. QED, you say there's a unique vacuum?
No.
It's exactly the same.
So there is
idea of what you would call a vacuum in a sense. There are different.
I don't think anybody has discussed it.
Well, they discuss some in and out states.
No, but the symmetry. So you could take the BMS paper.
What you call in and out states, there will be no unique. Let's say I have a matter in this theory, passive matter in this. There's no in and out state, of course. There's the same non-uniqueness for every in and out state that you're describing for the vacuum.
Right.
So it's really just this, how you're treating the soft infrared gravitons or photons. Right?
Maybe I spoke too fast. I don't think that the Hilbert space is... I'm not very clear about this, but I don't think the Hilbert space on Scry minus is just a tensor product.
Of what?
Why not?
Maybe the Hilbert space is a tensor product, but the S matrix is more complicated.
Yeah.
Yeah, the S matrix is complicated. Mixes things up in a complicated way. We can't just disentangle the soft sector from everything else, right? We make soft stuff, and yeah.
What you said about finite regions and putting things in a box, there's something that I think sort of goes over into this. It's something that in field theory is very singular. Namely, if I think about, I like to think about boxes that are causal diamonds, if you don't mind, but
yes,
any region with a boundary, you can think about gauge transformations that are pure gauge every place except within, you know, an infinitesimal region around the boundary and just affect the boundary of whatever region you're in. And I have the feeling that formally, if I think about things like that, that goes over into these the super translations of the BMS group at infinity. I mean, modulo, you know, sort of preserving the structure of null infinity. Does that sound
sounds
right
plausible?
No, it's exactly true.
I mean, it's exactly true.
That's at some level, I think, what Ashtekar and somebody showed in the late 80s.
What did they show?
The BMS translation, you know, it's just said in other words, a BMS transformation is a diffeomorphism. And if you would, you know, cut it off away from infinity, it's a null direction to symplectic structure. But it's a non-degenerate direction of the symplectic structure exactly because of a boundary term at infinity. So it's the same story as you always have when you have a boundary condition that makes some gauge transformations into things that act non-trivially on the phase space. I think you've said.
Okay, so you're saying we couldn't talk about BMS transformations at on finite.
Well, you could do what Tom wants to do, which is you could work at finite distance and impose extra boundary conditions, and then there could be an analog of BMS transformations. Mm-hmm. So it's the infinite size limit of a system, could be the infinite size limit of a system with a boundary. You can certainly do this in ADS to recover boundary gravitons in ADS 3. It's just a technical question of whether it works in Minkowski space.
I just wonder if it's useful to think about an incredibly trivial example of distinct spacetimes that are indistinguishable by their invariance. Like take Minkowski space and then stretch the spatial direction by five, factor of five.
Yeah.
You have another completely flat spacetime. It's the same spacetime. But if you could compare the first one to the second one, you could certainly see that something changed because two particles could be in a different, have a different distance from each other. So what I'm asking is it crucial that the metric has so much symmetry to describe that it admits these wouldn't be the case for a finite cone.
Wait, sorry, what was the question?
Maybe it's not a clear enough question for you to address
it. It's a good question. It's almost certainly true that when you try to do this business taking a finite system with boundary, look at what are its asymptotic symmetries, and then grow it, you're restricted to things that are, of course, symmetries of the boundary conditions you impose.
Right.
Okay. And it's generally true that if you try to, your finite system will have, the boundary conditions will have less symmetry than the infinite system it grows to. And so a minute ago I said in ADS3 you can do this with a cutoff, but what you actually find with a cutoff is, of course, you don't have the full set of conformal transformations at any finite distance. You only have some subset that's been preserved by the boundary conditions you impose, or at least in all known ways of doing it, which you find. So it's difficult to recover the full group by doing this. Yeah.
So as a practical matter, we need to vacate the room. Let's thank Andy for a very simple